From the company Creality I got the latest model of their CR10 series, the CR10 version 2. I already have tested the two predecessors, CR10 and CR10S in detail and I can say that both devices are great printers. Creality has continued to evolve the CR10 without getting lost in gadgets or even making things worse. The above average working area of 30x30x40cm was kept constant over the years, same as the basic construction using extruded aluminum for the frame and an external box for the electronics. Thankfully, even in the latest edition of the 3D printer, there is no color touchscreen with closed source drivers and also no cloud connectivity or other frippery. Same as in the first version of the CR10, the LCD has a resolution of 128x64 pixels and the device is still operated via a rotary switch. The output of the power supply is 24V DC at up to 14.6 amps, corresponding to 350 watts. The interior of the electronics box is very tidy, all plugs are locked in place with some hot glue. Thanks to the ATmega 2560 chip on the mainboard, the simple LCD and the rotary switch, all versions of the CR10 run with open source firmware, a customized version of Marlin is used here. According to the manufacturer, the source code will be published on the Creality homepage after all testing is done, I already received a pre-release version. The CR10 V2 ships more or less pre-assembled with only a couple of screws needed to assemble the frame. I needed no more than 3 hours to assemble the printer and set it all up for a first print, while taking photos and recording a couple of video sequences. Many of these high resolution pictures of the printer are available on my pages. What has changed over the years? The most striking feature of the new version 2 are the two additional struts on the frame, giving the printer a higher stiffness, only 2 more round rods on the right place. The part cooling fan is larger than it was at its predecessors and the air is now blown from the left and right to the tip of the nozzle, as we will see later, this improvement works well. Another new feature is the rubber insulation on the hot end, which, among other things, prevents the airflow for part cooling from hitting this part of the extruder. The movement of the print bed along the Y axis is still guided by 6 rollers. However, the middle pair of rollers always acts as an undesirable pivot point or is adjusted in such a way that it does not really touch the guiding rails, making it more or less useless. Same as at the two predecessors, I have removed the center pair of rollers. All pairs of rollers are designed in such a way that one roller can be pressed against the aluminum profile via an eccentric nut so that backlash can be eliminated. To my mind, this design is much better than the use of cheap linear ball bearings, which often come with too much backlash, having no chance to compensate. There's wear on the plastic rollers during operation, especially at the beginning, until the contact surfaces got planar over time. All in all, the wheels have proven to be very robust, there was no need to replace them at one of the predecessors I own, a little bit of lubricant reduces friction and so wear. The glass tile on the print bed is now coated, resulting in better adhesion of your prints. The metal clamps which keep the glass plate on the print bed are smaller and so the printhead won't crash into them whenever the whole print area is needed for large projects. However, smaller means that these are a bit more fiddly to operate. The new, extremely large knurled nuts for adjusting the height of the print bed are much more comfortable to use. Before the printer is switched on for the first time, the build plate is brought to a low position. The two sides of the X-axis must be adjusted to the same height over the bottom frame, for which the spindles of the Z-axis are turned manually. I'm using a 3D printed spacer, a ruler will do the job as well. After turning the device on, you can still hear the fans inside the electronic box, but the noise level is far more pleasant than with the very loud predecessor models. As a first test, I am homing all axes. The stepper motors are also running much quieter than the predecessor models, you almost can't notice any noise. Unfortunately, there's no way to automatically drive the printhead to the corner points of the build plate through the printer menu, a feature that was implemented in the firmware of the CR10S. I therefore use a special G-code file which drives to the corner points and stops at these for 15 seconds. Before the printhead moves to the next point, there is a warning beep sound. Leveling is now business as usual. The print bed is raised step by step. Until nothing but a sheet of paper fits tightly between tip of the nozzle and print bed. There is a thermal insulation on the bottom side of the print bed. A maximum temperature of 110 degrees Celsius can be set via the printer menu. ...40 degrees Celsius are reached after about 3 minutes... ...60 degrees Celsius after 5 minutes... ...90 degrees after 11 minutes... and 100 degrees Celsius after 14 minutes, which is more or less the maximum temperature, with the environmental temperature in my video studio being only about 14 degrees Celsius. The print bed heating is obviously more powerful than it is at the predecessor models. After preheating the hot end for PLA to 185 degrees Celsius, the filament must be inserted in the filament sensor, and after activating a lever on the extruder motor it can be pushed to the hot end, until plastic finally comes out of the nozzle. With that, the printer is prepared for a first job. Print jobs are now stored on a standard size SD card. The small micro SD cards of the previous models sometimes disappeared in the electronic box due to carelessness. Like its predecessors, the CR10V2 is made for large projects, however my first print is a very small chain link for a robotic vehicle. The first layer is printed at a height of 0.35 mm to compensate for any unevenness in the print bed. The print speed is set to 15 mm per second. The base area of the chain link is just 20 x 25 mm. The following layers are printed with a height of 0.2 mm, the default setting for almost all my projects. The print speed for the walls is 20 mm per second. The job is done after about 12 minutes. Chainlink number 2 is used to test the power failure function. For this I turn off the printer during operation. The nozzle is still hot and so plastic continues to flow out of the hot end forming a visible drop. After switching on again you can resume the job via the printer menu. To do so, print bed and hot end are heated up to the target temperature first. After that, the printhead moves to the limit switches of the X and Y axis, before the printer continues with the job. The plastic drop is blurred in the layer, which is clearly visible at the tiny chain link due to the very thin walls. But even with this flaw, you get a really proper chain link when the job is done. The part snaps nicely to the first link I have made. With chain link number 3, I will check the filament sensor. As soon as the printer runs out of filament, the printhead moves to the limit switches of the X and Y axis. After inserting a new spool of filament, you can resume the job. I'm using blue filament to illustrate the change. In addition to the color change, the location of the print interruption can be recognized by the thick plastic strings, which are easy to remove after printing. You might have noticed that shortly before the print was interrupted, too much plastics came out of the nozzle. This is due to the fact that the filament is often retracted while the tiny chain link is printed. The end of a filament strand is usually warped and thumped, which causes the plastic to get stuck in the filament sensor during retraction. A different design of the filament path inside the sensor would solve this problem. There is always something to improve on every printer. All in all, the filament sensor is a very helpful component that will save one or the other of your print jobs. The chain link is successfully completed after the filament change. To improve bed adhesion, I put some glue on the surface of the glass tile. With that, the many small parts of the next print job will stick reliably on the bed. I'm printing a total of 13 links being aligned at different angles on the build plate. Same as before, the first layer is printed with a height of 0.35 mm. Again, the following layers are adjusted to 0.2 mm. With the different arrangement of the chain links on the print bed, you can check whether the part cooling fan works fine from all sides or if something is wrong with the movement of the X and Y axis. Ideally, all chain links should be identically. With bad cooling, you could see the edges of the knobs bent upwards while printing, which is not the case here. The new fan geometry on the printhead obviously works perfect. Same is for the overhangs on the only 1.5 mm thin walls at the front and back sides of the chain links, these are all printed nicely. After the job is done, the chain can be assembled directly out of the printer. As already mentioned, the individual parts are only 20x15x9mm big. Other components for my new robot are the wheels of the vehicle. Especially on the drive wheels, there are pointed overhangs that are printed perfectly due to the good working part cooling fan. The chassis has lots of 3mm openings for attaching payloads. The wall thickness is just 2mm with hexagonal openings for 3mm nuts on the inside. With 55x110x41mm it is the largest component of the robotic vehicle, but for the CR10 V2 this is still a rather small print job. You can see slight warping at the corners of the base plate, not at least caused by the low environmental temperature of no more than 14 degrees Celsius in my video studio. The overall adhesion on the build plate is quite good. The walls of the robot chassis are really straight and also the cutouts for motors and rear axle look good. A printer with a large print volume is of course made for larger projects. Here I print the mount for the reflector of a Volkswagen Golf 2 headlamp, which I would like to install in my London taxi in order to adapt its headlight to the continental European traffic. For temperature stability, I'm using PETG for this component. I have raised the print speed. The parameters are printed at 30mm per second. and the 25% infill in honeycomb pattern is set to 60mm per second. The extruder doesn't show skipping, the torque of the stepper motor is sufficiently high and the mechanics pushes the filament reliably towards hot end. In addition to the large print volume, this is also a test of the capabilities of the power supply. The bed temperature is set to 100 degrees Celsius and the hot end to 235 degrees Celsius, so that both heating elements are operated near their limits, resulting in a required electrical power output that scrapes at the maximum. The regulated fans inside the electronics box are working at full speed, resulting in a more audible sound, but the noise level is still clearly below that of the predecessors. The dimensions of the headlight mount are 23×21×14cm. The layer height is set to 0.2mm as in the previous prints. For large components like this one, a higher value is recommended to shorten the printing time. Especially with this headlight mount that comes without fine details, you could use a 1mm nozzle. With my standard settings used here, the print is some sort of reliability test. The job is done after about 45 hours, almost 2 days. The printer worked fine during this time, you can't recognize any deviations caused by irregular movement of the axis. Due to the glossy surface of the transparent filament, there is a visible vertical seam to the left, being the starting point of multiple layers. It is clearly visible, but hard to feel. Furthermore, vertical lines are noticeable, which are mainly due to the fact that the circles in my CAD model are divided into only 100 segments, which is obviously not enough for the large diameter. All in all, the headlight mount came out of the printer as it should. It fits perfectly in the coachwork of my personal stagecoach. Creality has listened to its community and so the second version of the CR10 has been improved where it should. The frame is more sturdy, fans and motors run much quieter, the heated bed is more powerful and the flow of the part cooling has been optimized. If your budget is limited, the two still available predecessor models are a good option, however the second version of the CR10 is definitely worth the extra charge. You can get high resolution photos of the prints made in this video and more on my pages, with that you get an own impression of the print quality. Thanks for watching and I'll be back.